The purpose of this particular session is not to give presentations on particular topics and engage in long lecturing, but rather to present to you on the stage many of the people and people that have been presenting today, and give you the opportunity to ask them questions and to engage in a more relaxed dialogue on some of the questions relating to the way in which science and business and industry can communicate between themselves. And so, if I may offer a few words of introduction by saying that one of the motivations for establishing the Arctic Circle several years ago was to create a venue where representatives of different constituencies, namely of the scientific community, of industry and the investment community, environmental organizations, and the diplomatic and political community, could actually gather in one venue and interact between themselves rather than to meet in separate compartments having very specialized dialogues on very defined topics requiring great specialization. So I think one of the successes of the Arctic Circle has been to successfully create this platform and venue. But I think we can also, but still, make a greater effort to facilitate and encourage a dialogue between the scientific community on the one hand and the diplomatic and political community on the other, and certainly, of course, between the scientific community and those doing pure scientific research on the one hand, and industry and investment and business communities. And I have noticed in the presentations this morning that there is quite a bit of discussion on the relationship between, for example, science and politics and decision makers and those to make policy. And there's been quite a bit of discussion on the importance of engaging the indigenous communities. But there's not been so much mention or discussion of the way in which the scientific community actually communicates with industry and the business community in many different ways. And I think there are perhaps three ways of organizing this discussion. The first aspect of it would be the way in which scientific research is organized, that is to say, the way in which scientific knowledge is created, and the way in which the scientific community interacts with industry and business in the way in which scientific research is performed, funded, organized, and so on. And the second aspect of it would be the way in which scientific information and findings of science are disseminated, how the scientific community communicates with the business community, industry, and the wider community. And and the third aspect of this would be the way in which scientific information feed into decisions on investments, that is to say, the formal ways in which the investment community and businesses use scientific information to organize their work and to make decisions on investments. And so if we try to organize this discussion along in these three compartments, and we will then, if I may suggest, begin to discuss the way in which scientific research is organized and how the scientific community interacts with the business community in the organization of scientific research. And if I may begin by asking Alan Pope of the International Arctic Science Committee to comment on this particular topic, given that Alan has organized two sessions of the Arctic Circle assemblies on this very topic in the past. So if we can start off by discussing this particular aspect of it, and if I may then ask Volker Rachold to comment on this aspect, and then we will head on to the the second and third aspect of this topic.
Sure, yeah. So at the last two Arctic Circle assemblies, we brought together a group of researchers as well as representatives of industry to really focus a discussion around examples of how they had cooperated across that boundary in the past and to share some lessons learned and lessons to take forward. So these are not my wonderful thoughts and experiences. I should hasten to say that really I'm just stealing ideas from our wonderful panelists, and I don't want to, I should put credit where it's due. So in no particular order, one starting point for discussion was that we're talking about a dialogue between science and industry. And in both years, panelists highlighted that perhaps we should see that rather than as a two-way street, as more of a triangle, and that there's a strong role for intermediate organizations or government organizations to broker that relationship. So whether that's convening around a region, a particular question, or a particular goal, having an intermediate organization or can help bridge the science industry divide a little bit. Both years we talked a lot about building trust and about building shared understanding about motivations and incentives. So in the first year we had a representative of then Statoil, now Equinor, and a lot of the discussion started out with, well, how do you not be defensive? How do you engage with groups and really understand what the shared goals and shared aims are? This year we talked a lot about how you get research students involved in industry-led projects, which can be a great opportunity for students, but then there's the concerns around, well, if you're a PhD student, you need to be able to publish in the next 2 years or else your career is completely shut down. So maybe don't choose that super secret, although really exciting project for that. Maybe wait till the postdoc for that or something like that. Also around shared incentives and shared motivations was around data sharing and provision. That there's significant regional and country contexts for what requirements there are in terms of sharing data, what ability there is to share data, and that can be a really important topic at the beginning of building a relationship between industry and research. Another topic was on really a shared focus on societal benefit that a lot of industry and business in the North really does want to serve societal interests in the North, as does the research community. And so that can be a really good way to start relationships. A lot of the discussion focused around the physical sciences, and we had to be reminded both years by members of the audience, in fact, that social science plays a really strong role in science and industry cooperation, whether that's looking forwards, whether that's looking at local participation. Research is much broader than just ice cores or just sea ice, and it's important to remember that. And so I guess I'll end with two final points. One, that we really want to emphasize the two-way relationship between industry and research communities. And that's not just in terms of, you know, sharing data or sharing resources, sharing opportunities. It's also in sharing people and capacity, and that setting this up as two separate communities might actually not really fully represent the fact that there's a lot of, obviously, industry investment in science, and there's a lot of flow of the same people between those communities. And so rather than starting off as thinking of two separate communities, think of it as really a shared community working within two separate systems sometimes. And finally, that there's a lot of shared benefit to be had. It's not always easy to start off with, but can be really successful with commitment and grit, seeing it through. Thanks.
Thank you very much. If I may remind you that we very much would like to encourage questions during this session, so please note down your thoughts and raise your hands as we go along. But if I may ask Volker Rachold to comment on this particular aspect of this theme, and perhaps given that the mandate of the German Arctic Office is to give advice and consult government and industry on developments in the Arctic, and what the implications, for example, are of the melting sea ice for activities in the Arctic, and also given your past engagement with the International Arctic Science Committee, what may have been the examples possible that illustrate these complications of scientific engagement with topics that are sensitive from a political point of view, for example.
Yeah, thank you for the question. So, first of all, let me start by saying this is exactly why I always come to the Arctic Circle, because the Arctic Circle for me is a venue where I can meet people from various different communities, and I think it's for the Arctic, it's probably the only one that you have a conference where you meet, let's say, all stakeholders from science, industry, politics that are interested in the Arctic at one single place. And I think that's really a key story of success to the Arctic Circle, I would think. So, but speaking about the link between science and industry, I think there are a couple of points that we should keep in mind. Firstly, this is structured and organized very differently in all the countries. For example, in Germany, we have two things. One is called knowledge transfer, and that is transferring science to politics. And then we have technology transfer, which talks about transferring science to industry or cooperating with industry. And this is pretty clearly separated. So my institute has mechanisms for knowledge transfer, like my office, but we also have a separate department for technology transfer, so people working with the industry. So that is one thing. The other thing, of course, I think, which is also a problem, or I wouldn't call it a problem, but a reason is that at least the big companies, of course, they have their own scientists. So they do their own science. Well, they are not really dependent on getting external advice from scientists because they have their own science departments. So I'm a geologist, and when I started to work, some of my colleagues started working for the industry, and others went into science. So, I mean, they also do science for the industry, but it's a different kind of science. I think that's probably part of the explanation. There are some things starting, and we are also starting this in Germany. Shipping, for example, is an example. And I think the main point is that the development of the Arctic will continue in any case. And I think our role as a scientist is to make sure that it is done in a way that is not harmful for the Arctic and that is sustainable for the Arctic. And for that, of course, you need the scientific background, and for that, of course, you need basic science to also inform industry on how things should be done. And I think that's kind of our role, that we provide the knowledge to make this development of the Arctic sustainable. And so the format of this kind of dialogue that we have here, or that IS is organizing at the Arctic Circle, is, I think, extremely important.
Thank you very much. May I invite a question from the audience at this stage on this particular aspect of this topic, namely the way in which scientific research is organized and the two-way relationship between science and industry in scientific research. If I may ask a question to Volker following this comment, I mean, can you comment on this, very particularly in the Arctic context? Would you say that there are many big corporations that have their own research departments that are doing research independently in the Arctic that is of great consequence, but perhaps does not find its way into the standard publications of the Arctic Council, for example?
Of course they do. And I think also the shipbuilding industry, they do their own research. So I would guess that the development of the LNG tankers, you have your own science department for doing that. And I would assume, and I think this is for all the big industry, that they don't really depend on, let's say, external scientific advice. So it's always us as scientists approaching industry as our stakeholders, but they don't come to us normally, I would think.
And would it be possible to argue that the Arctic Council or the formal mechanism on collaboration science in the Arctic could improve its efforts in approaching the research communities of the of big industry in the region?
As I said, there are efforts. Of course, the Arctic Circle is a good example, but also the Arctic Council, I think, noted that. And that was also, I would think, one of the arguments and backgrounds behind the Arctic Economic Council. So that the Arctic Economic Council is also meant to better connect science and industry, not only industry itself, but also connected to science, and to make sure that the development of the Arctic is done in a proper and sustainable way, and not just by anyone who just wants to invest. That was my understanding of the reason of the Arctic Economic Council.
Perhaps if I may move this discussion on to the second aspect of the way in which we want to organize this discussion, namely on the way in which knowledge and scientific information is disseminated to the international community and to the public and the policymakers and diplomats and politicians. If I may ask Jim Gamble to possibly comment on that aspect of it. And be mindful of this context of the way in which there may, so if the question is about how we communicate scientific knowledge and involve the indigenous communities, for example, both in the creation of knowledge and how it is disseminated, that there may be information, that the structure of the way in which this information is created may be more complicated than we often perhaps realize.
Well, thanks for that. I think I'll answer that question, but first I just want to kind of make a general comment about this discussion about the Arctic Council and sort of their relationship with business and industry in the Arctic. And what I'll say about that is that, having observed and been involved in many Arctic Council activities over the years, the Arctic Council has always been willing to ask advice from industry. That's pretty clear, especially at the working group level. The PAME working group, for example, frequently has presentations from various industry and organizations, particularly related to projects that they might be working on. And other working groups do the same. Now, that being said, so that information makes its way into Arctic Council reports and other work items. But that being said, there's always been a sort of philosophy at the Arctic Council that business and industry be kept at arm's length. So in other words, they can be invited to give information and potentially be involved in subcommittees or organizations under the Arctic Council. But there can never be a perception that industrial or business interests are somehow driving the agenda of the Arctic Council. And so I think sometimes the Arctic Council will err on the side of caution with regard to that, which means that sometimes I think they do keep business and industry a bit further away than they need to be. And I think, as Volker mentioned, the creation of the Arctic Economic Council was very much a reaction to that. You know, we need another body sort of to deal more directly with business and industry. And I think the idea of the Arctic Economic Council is a really good one, and I think once, you know, it gets traction and sort of grows into its role a little bit, I think it's going to serve a very, very good, a very meaningful role, a very important one. As far as dissemination and outreach on information, it's a really good question because, of course, from a permanent participant point of view, it's a two-way street, and as it should be. So in other words, the Arctic Council is doing important work on Arctic issues, and the permanent participants and indigenous communities through the permanent participants, they're participating in that work. So in other words, they're providing information, and really they have every expectation that the information they're providing, the work products that are being created, the tools and reports and other items that are the results of this work, that they should really benefit the people at the community level. Sometimes I think that's a goal that we lose. Sometimes I think interest and needs of the communities get a bit lost in some of the higher level scientific and research questions. I think we often would try in virtually everything to find what would be the community's interest in this. And that sometimes is a that sometimes is a metric you can use to decide how much resources you want to put into a particular element of Arctic Council work. Now, that being said, there are some things that were so that were and are so fundamentally important that they deserved our time and attention regardless. And one of them we heard about last session, and that was the agreement on scientific cooperation in the Arctic. Now, that's a very high-level, it's a very high-level thing that talks about things that happen at the community level, right? Research at the community level. And so we judged that our attention to that process and our work to ensure that there was a section on traditional knowledge, as we found out, that was worth our time. And I think had we not put the effort we did into that, it's quite likely that traditional knowledge might well have been left out of the Arctic, the agreement on Arctic scientific cooperation. Not that people question its importance, but simply because it's a long, complicated process, and you know, what we're constantly trying to do is make a sort of a big document with lots of ideas a smaller document that everybody can agree on and sign at the end of the day. So some ideas get lost, and we wanted to make sure that the idea that traditional knowledge is a part of Arctic science, we wanted to make sure it didn't get lost. And so I'll just say one final thing, and that is that if you think of the permanent participants at the Arctic Council and compare them to the Arctic states or other organizations that are there, the permanent participants are trying to do more with a lot less than most of those other states and organizations. So in other words, I'll give you the example of Aleut International Association. We had three staff that were working on Arctic Council issues. Two were full-time, one was part-time. And we were trying to cover six working groups, three task forces, the senior Arctic officials meetings, and a number of project-related activities. In other words, we couldn't cover it all. There's just no way. And part of our work with all that is making sure that what's coming out of those task forces and working groups and ministerial processes gets to the communities. And so we've got to disseminate that to 13 communities. Well, that's just Aleut International Association. Inuit Circumpolar Council has many, many more communities and many, many more Arctic residents that they're trying to talk to. So it's a really important part of the job, but it's also a very resource-intensive part of the job, and we have to figure out how to use our resources most efficiently. So end of the day, it's important to us, and we try our hardest, but we simply don't have the resources to do as good a job with it as we want. And that would be something we could improve with more support and more cooperation at higher levels.
Would you be, if may I ask, if given that this is a daunting task and there's this wealth of information and so on, if I may ask a quick follow-up question on this comment. In your experience, when you observe the research activities of the formal academic institutions and the institutes that are have the mandate for scientific research and compare that to the research projects that you have observed by corporations or industry, in terms of how they take into account local knowledge and information and experience that can be found in the indigenous communities, can you comment on that briefly, you know, the comparison between the two?
Yeah, absolutely. It's an interesting process because it's really evolved, I would say, over the time. And it's evolved in the time that, so I've been in this work really full-time about 12 years. And since the beginning, around the time I came on with Aleut International Association was right about the time when their academic institutions were I think, making more of an effort to understand traditional knowledge and include Arctic communities more in their work. I think since that time, we've definitely seen improvements in the way that's happened. Now, if I compare and contrast that with industry, it's an interesting compare and contrast because the reality is that for industry, where there is a potential benefit or economic incentive, they are pretty good about doing it, you know, about going to communities and holding community meetings, because in a way, it's a box that they feel they need to check, in order to be right morally with the work that they're doing. I don't want to be overly hard on them, except to say that I think, you know, most people want to do the right thing, but economic interest sometimes trumps that. And so the interesting thing is that when regulatory mechanisms or simply public perception are involved, the industry was a lot more likely to collaborate and work together. Scientific research and academic institutions, truthfully, not so much, until sort of we've had this bit of a shift in the perception. And that's where the improvements I've seen have come, is with more so with academic institutions sort of understanding this. And if I had to talk about both in terms of their role after the fact, I'd say that there's truthfully not a lot of difference. The majority are not that great about coming back and explaining what they found and what happened and what it might mean for the community. Some of course are, and that's typically really, really appreciated by the community, and that follow up and that relationship building can lead to other things later on. So,
thank you.
Yeah, thanks.
Thank you. So if I may move on to Fry Ditchman, I hope I pronounced that reasonably well. You wanted to comment on this, and perhaps you can do it in the context of the presentation you made on the research proposals by the Danish government.
Well, I wanted to comment on the dissemination part to begin with, because I think that in Denmark we've had quite a discussion on this, because we have a lot of researchers going to Greenland, and in our discussion with the Greenlandic Authority, we hear that we should do more to make science relevant for the community, the local community, and make it relevant for the Greenlandic. So we say, okay, so we keep pushing an agenda of dissemination to our researchers and say, you gotta disseminate your research to the community. I think we have a problem with our Danish researchers that they are not educated, and a new PhD, a postdoc are not educated on how to handle local community, how to disseminate very complex research to a tradition that is different from your own. So I think we also got to look at how we educate our own PhDs in, for example, Denmark or where it is, and when they become, let's say, Arctic researchers, they need to have that skill set to know how to communicate, because there are different traditions and different ways of absorbing knowledge. And also there's, I think a lot of times communicate better if you already have a trust and a network with the people that you want to communicate with. You can't just show up one day, present something at a PowerPoint, and then leave the next. And that's not how we experience that good dissemination of research. So there we need to also educate our young researchers on how to do this. And I wanted also to talk about maybe just science and business. I think there are kind of two discussions or two levels in this discussion. The one is, you know, industry, as we heard about shipbuilding or mining and these big industries. But I think there's also we have a responsibility to communicate a little more on the smaller scale. So the entrepreneurship, how to make new businesses, how to develop new areas of income and business in the local community. So all this is very much a part of educating the young people to see the opportunities, to know how to develop businesses and give them the tool set to do that. Because I don't think that big industries and the research community have a difficulty talking. They can make seminars like this, and they can talk, and they can see, okay, we could do something for you. But it's different for smaller communities and the youth in these communities to have that, to get into that mindset and actually see the opportunities, because I'm sure there's plenty of good ideas there. They just need to be the overcome some obstacles. And I think that, I mean, we want to focus a little more on entrepreneurship and stuff like that to kind of help this along.
Okay, so if I understand you correctly, then you're saying that in terms of the research community on the one hand and the in research done by industry on the other, there's not such a great difference. But isn't it a fundamental question when discussing both the scientific research by the research community and industry on the one hand, and then the dissemination of information and how the scientific findings are shared with the local, regional, and international community, that the incentives by, on the one hand, the community that is formally mandated with scientific research and funded by public funds and taxpayers' money, are fundamentally different from the incentives and the duties that are there in the case of the research done by industry. So in other words, you would have the possibility of a corporation doing fundamental research on fundamentally important questions for the understanding of the development of the planet, but they do not have the same duty or incentives to share that information with the community. Can you comment on that possibly? I mean, isn't that a fundamental question about the differences between these two research communities?
Well, yes, it is. I don't have a quick fix on how to get about that, but it's obvious that there are some industries that are going to keep their, let's say, findings, research findings, quite close to their to themselves in order to exploit it in a business fashion. But I think if it's taxpayer-funded research, then I think we're on a path of pushing an open science agenda that's going to remedy at least that portion of it. But if it's privately funded research, I think it's going to be it's more difficult. I don't see that we can, at least from a Danish perspective, if we have the legislation to actually force upon industries to disclose things that might be, let's say, important to development of their business. I don't see that happening anytime soon. But it's sure that the publicly funded research should and must always be opened and accessible to all.
Hi. It's not so much a question, but perhaps more of an intervention that hopefully gets at some of the comments that have been put forward so far. Just three examples. Two in a Canadian north, which is not really the Arctic, I know, but in the Canadian context, it's still seen as a north. And the other one is from the Norwegian north. My name, by the way, is Eileen Espiritu. I'm at the Arctic University of Norway. The first two examples are from the the University of Saskatchewan in Saskatoon in Canada. The first is something that was already mentioned earlier in the morning sessions, and that's the partnership between academics and Indigenous peoples with regards to research. There's a research group at the University of Saskatchewan called the Delta Research Group. There's a big river that runs through Saskatchewan called the North Saskatchewan River, and along that river are Indigenous peoples who live along deltas. And what researchers have found is that in order for them to be able to engage with Indigenous peoples from the very, very first moment that a research project is drawn up, they're already writing that research project with the Indigenous communities. And so they know the direction that research should go in order to benefit the community. Let me just preface this by saying that the three examples that I'll be giving you has to do a lot with, is very, very much related to social responsibility of not just the academic, but also of industry. So that's the social responsibility of the academic, is to, at the very, very basic level, the baseline, to already be engaging with Indigenous peoples. The second example is also at the University of Saskatchewan, but more Saskatchewan as a whole, and that's engagement with the University of Saskatchewan in terms of education with Cameco, which is an international uranium company. And what they are doing is educating, again, indigenous communities in the provincial north.
Can you present that in a question to the
panel? Yes, I am. But the third example is that of Northern Norway and Statoil's provision of entrepreneurial or business PhDs to PhD level. I realize this is a very much a community level. These are very much community level examples, and I'm not sure how to bring that to the Arctic Council. So my question is, how do we bring those kinds of good practice, best practice solutions to the Arctic Council?
Thank you.
Put it to you.
Jim, do you want to give a very short answer to this?
Well, first of all, thanks a lot for presenting three examples. We could all go look and see the projects you're talking about. And I know examples like those in Alaska, for instance, that are really very successful. And your initial point was key, because most of these examples include very early involvement of communities and indigenous peoples in the very research question development. I mean, before you even figure out your question, you really should be in the community talking about it. So the question is how to bring this up to the Arctic Council level. Well, I'll answer it in a couple of ways. One, to say that at some levels it already is, because some of the research that's being done in the Arctic Council, especially that involves communities, it's happening through the permanent participants. And the very mechanisms you're talking about are ones that the permanent participants aspire to and use early and often a consultation, development of research priorities and questions in concert with indigenous peoples, respect for the traditional knowledge and recognizing that it's not a component of research, it's a knowledge system that is operating quite nicely, thank you, without science ever being involved. So all of those things, I think, are things that the permanent participants aspire to. The problem that develops is that the Arctic Council expects that the permanent participants will do that. And for the very reasons I talked about earlier, the permanent participants can't always do that because they simply don't have the resources. And so with all of the research going on in the Arctic, with all of the research, just that subset that the Arctic Council is involved with, even then, the permanent participants, they want to do it, they have the ability to do it with the proper resources, but they just simply don't have the resources. So one fundamental question about how to make this better, how to get the permanent participants more resources.
Thank you. So there's another question waiting in the audience by Hadla Hund, but if I may, Hadla, you'll just hold on for a few minutes, because I want to bring the discussion to the third aspect of this general theme, namely to the question or the way how to think about the way in which industry and business consumes and uses information from the scientific community in their investment decisions and how they communicate with the science community. And so if I may also to bring in the panelists who are more on the business side of this discussion or the industry side. So as an entry into an effort to bring this aspect of this theme into the discussion, if I may ask Michael Perkinson to comment on that in general, and perhaps in particular to tell us a little bit more about the collaboration between Guggenheim Partners and the World Wildlife Fund, which is a wonderful example of an interesting collaboration between two different organizations, which you mentioned in your presentation, but would be very interesting to hear more about, also because of the recent publication you mentioned in your presentation. And then if you can move on to Odin Kwon and then get the question from Hatla.
Great, thank you, Dogfin. So Dogfin kindly refers to a collaboration that Guggenheim has undertaken with the World Wildlife Fund, principally, although not exclusively, in the United States. And the World Wildlife Fund, I think, represents a number of scientific interests And what I can say is that their perspective has certainly contributed to the way that we think about investments, particularly infrastructure investments. And I also can't overlook the fact that I live in a state in the United States, the state of California, that if it were an independent country, it would have the fourth largest economy on the planet. And there are numerous examples, probably better than the one at Guggenheim, of collaboration between science and business. The second or third best technical university in the world is Cal State in Pasadena, and a lot of businesses employ Cal State grads to work on battery technology for non-fuel vehicles or electric vehicles. They are also employed in Silicon Valley and cloud-based computing projects. So I think that there are a number of examples where business benefits from science. I think the big challenge is how does business then contribute back to science? Thank you.
Thank you very much. Hadla, if you yes. like to pose your question.
Thank you so much, and thanks to all of you for your comments. We've talked a lot about today the importance of incorporating indigenous knowledge in decision making and science and so forth. But I want to turn this a bit around and pose the question, maybe in the context of how business and science, the science community can work together. Are we doing enough to empower indigenous young people to be a part of the science community instead of us consulting indigenous communities in our research? What about establishing scholarships to actually bring them into the dialogue as researchers for the long run? And by doing that, they become a part of the scientific dialogue of the research that then features directly, hopefully, in a better way into policymaking. I would love to hear your thoughts on this.
Thank you. Thank you very much for a great question. So Jim has raised his hand, but I must ask you to be brief. And also, I think it would be interesting if Alan Pope could comment on this very briefly, because it's very much part of his mandate. And then I suggest we move on to our friends, our hosts from Korea, and hear their insights on some of these themes. So Jim, if you... because we will soon be out of time, so please be brief.
All right. Thanks very much. And just so you know, I'll raise my hand on most of the questions, so feel free to just say no. I won't. My feelings won't be hurt. Okay. Now, thanks for this question. It's a really, really good one, and it's a fundamental one. You're absolutely right. One of the ways we solve this problem is through indigenous scholars. Your ideas are really, really good, but I suggest we take it one step further, because what we really need is indigenous knowledge institutions generally. And we have examples of that. We have Sami Technical University, for instance, other institutions that are actually run and conceived by the indigenous peoples themselves. So when we have that, we will have, as I think Alan actually mentioned, one of the mechanisms is indigenous ambassadors who bridge the gap between the scientific community and the indigenous community. It's absolutely essential. It's something that we have to have in order to really make this work in the way it can work.
Thank you very much. Alan, if you can comment on this briefly.
Yeah, I'll agree with that. And I think two other things I would add is that there are some resources available. For example, IASC does try and financially support early career indigenous scientist participation in our meetings. And one thing we've been running into is not getting enough people to take us up on that offer. And so we know we need to do better at that. So even the opportunities that are there aren't being sufficiently leveraged yet. And I think one challenge on that, some of it is systemic. For example, when you're asking early career researchers to fund participation and get reimbursed afterwards, that's a few thousand dollars that might not actually be possible. So there's really on the ground level. Impediments, but then there's also larger impediments of sometimes you're asking people to choose with one type of identity or another and think about themselves as indigenous or as scientists, and that is a bigger problem that we need to get around.
Thank you very much. If I may now suggest or direct my question to Odin Kwon of Daewoo and ask or suggest or invite you to make observations about the way in which the relationship between science and industry comes across from your vantage point in the shipbuilding industry, and perhaps also interestingly because of the implications for the LNG projects.
Thank you. Actually, nowadays, the industry is more complex, and also we have to combine some IT technology to conventional civil, architectural, mechanical, maritime, everything. And also globally, the rule and regulation by the shipbuilding company governed by IMO and the Arctic Council and the Flag Administration and other society like class ship society, etc., and Flag Administration, they make some rule and we should follow. But in order to the target is one thing in IMO is MARPOL, pollution. So there are three pollution. One is air pollution. Second thing is go to water. Third one, any cavity or sort of solid material. Another one thing is solas, the safety of the crew members or even environmental. So how to combine this thing, the safety and environmental issue. So now mainly EU driver, the IMO, to reduce the oil emissions. So that's why we also discuss about the LNG, but currently, for the time being, LNG can reduce the emission first. And also, two, now the due to global warming, so the ice is still melting, but still plenty of ice over there. So now some vessel passing through the Northern Sea Route, but we have to provide some sound and strong vessel, even melting. So maybe, I don't know when, the 2030, 2040, someone say, scientists say, the ice will melting. Then maybe Bering Strait to Iceland directly. Oh, then I think the Iceland is another one, the good hub of the logistics something, but still many ice. So even summer season, from July to November, some vessel with ice crust vessel can sail Northern Sea Route. But anyhow, we have to have a good enough strengthening and also well protected of Arctic area. Even now, the polar code is banned of using HFO, but other fuels like MGO, still when spill in the oil, Arctic, it's another disaster. So, you know, many years ago, the Exxon Valdez, even Alaska, is crude oil. But after HFO, now MGO. So very soon, all Arctic vessels should use LNG as a main fuel, or after that, some other type of the fuel, like biofuel or some other thing. So in terms of engineering side, try to keep the environment issue, but how to make the reasonable solution in terms of CapEx and OPEX? Because even expensive solution, then they will never go with this expensive vessel with the Arctic Northern Sea Route. That's why some compromising of technology and economic solution together.
Thank you.
It's another hurdle, but some other issues like science and communication, everything also will follow when the lawyer or some international government made a strong rule, then you can build.
Thank you very much. If I may suggest that we draw this to a close with insights and comments from Shin, Hyoung, Chul, and Kim Jong-deog, who represent, on the one hand, the Korean Polar Research Institute and the Korea Maritime Institutes, and they are our hosts, and therefore, as representatives of major scientific organizations in a country that has become a major industrial power, it would be interesting to hear your thoughts and insights on the relationship between science and industry. So if how is this in the experience of the Korea Polar Research Institute?
Okay, I'll do it first. Okay, because it is about between science and business and science and application, I'll just offer to comment what I have been thinking since lunchtime. Now, science can be useful in a wider way, or science can be readily usable in a more direct way. For example, science can serve the public good, the wider community, or science can service for the profits or benefits of a particular entity in a more commercial way. Whichever, linking science to application is not going to be automatic. We need something in between. So science may know what it can offer, but may not know how exactly it can be of utility, and vice versa. I will just list three cases that comes to top of my head from COPRI. We have modeling capability, and we have weather prediction service here, and we have sea ice science, and we have northern sea route logistics, and we have here like low temperature adapted biology and biochemistry, and we have pharmaceutical or anti-UV pharmaceutical. These are the three cases that I can think of that COPRI has been struggling, but it has not been easy. We lack something in how to link them. So my thinking is that we need something in between. Whether we have to call it intermediator or brokerage, then I would rather be on the side of intermediator. When we did it in brokerage way, it was not smooth. It was not always easy, and I think still brokerage way will be have only limited success. So we will have to be thinking of something more systematic approach. I cannot specify today, but it will be food for thought for a very long while.
This is issues science and business cooperation. It's not just agenda in the Arctic is very normal in everywhere. I'd like to take one example of recent Korea. Recently, we are very suffering from the fine dust in the air. Many people, they understood that this fine dust comes from some manufacturer systems. But our observations, in particular in the coastal region, we recognize that the vessel contributes a lot to the fine dust. In my town, Busan, more than 30% of the fine dust comes from vessels, because the vessels, they should turn on the engine if they are parking on the sea. So every year, more than 80,000 big vessels coming out Busan port. So when we know that, the government changed their policies. They tried to talk about how to reduce technologically the emissions and how they can control some areas, for example, adopting the IMO ECA emission control areas, and also how to provide additional powers to the parking vessels on the sea. It changed a lot. So now it's moving to outside. So what I mean is the scientific research and results to have some consensus with others, including business. They have to have very concrete results and clear directions or meaning. So that's my first point. Secondly, as Jim mentioned during his presentations, we need to use the social science as well. Alan mentioned that. So we are doing the indigenous use mapping in sea areas of the Aleutian Island. The traditional knowledges, through the technologies and science, it produced concrete map, and their government accepted that map as a guideline. That means the business should avoid that areas. It means they should pay some additional cost for their management. So this is a kind of the circulations of the science and local people and government and business. So business science directly, of course, it's okay, but sometimes the government and local and society should involve that communication and talking on some matters. So we need to include social science factors to our science and business cooperation. And the Arctic Council's particular PAIM working groups, they established the Arctic shipping best practice projects since 2016. As they have this conference, forums, back-to-back of the IMO conference. So in the IMO, many businessmen join that conference. So they show their best practice by the business and by the academic areas. They share information. So we need to expand this kind of the best practice in various levels, at the council or the other indigenous society meetings. So that can be provide very good platform to solve this agenda as well. So, and lastly, as I mentioned my presentations, we need to have some sharing platform as well. So data, statistics, information, evidence can be shared in some one platform. I don't know, but we started our initiatives with Arctic Portal to solve this kind of the very enormous problem of challenges in the Arctic. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So we are out of time. I think perhaps one way of summarizing this discussion or concluding it would be to say that there can be all kinds of fruitful relationships between business and science, but that the discussion will always be incomplete without discussing the role of the government and regulations and the way in which that legislative process defines what the relationship between science and business can be in different contexts and internationally and globally. So thank you very much for your observations, and thank you for today, and we will continue tomorrow morning.